Hi guys. My name is Dale Schlunt, and I'm a faculty member at Palo Alto College, as many of you who watch my videos probably know. And one of the courses that I frequently teach is 1301 U.S. History. The time frame is relatively expansive. We talk about everything from European exploration of the Americas, or what they were often referred to as the New World, all the way to Reconstruction. Yet in my classes, I like to take about a week at least to look at pre-Columbian societies in the Americas. The Americas referring to, right, North, Central, South America, and of course pre-Columbian referring to before Columbus, right? Columbus arrives in the West Indies and of course spurs more European exploration. Before all that, the indigenous populations in the Americas, they had some amazing achievements. We often think of them as just, right, one big group, right, all together, all similar, but they were multifaceted, diverse. Some of these societies even turning into what historians would define as civilizations. And among these achievements, of course, we can talk about the domestication of plants that were indigenous to the Americas and the agricultural practices that followed. You know, and that's what I wanted to do, is I wanted to share with you corn, beans, and of course squash. I wanted to share this garden with you because due to the pandemic, for one reason, I thought, you know, I'm always talking about this, studying about this. Why not actually do it and show my students, and of course other people as well, bring some of this history to life? Of course, I started this in the beginning of the COVID pandemic, right, last March, and that garden was so much better, I assure you. you know, I always like to think, you know, gosh, I have some skills that would help me live off the land, right? Quite obviously, I'll be visiting Whataburger this year, to be sure. Nevertheless, we'll harvest some of this stuff and incorporate it into our meals. The story, though, is what makes history so great. Just this one plant, maize, corn, just that one plant offers this rich narrative that is by no means boring. You know how long ago the domestication process of corn began? 8,000 to 9,000 years ago. I mean, over thousands of years. And it took quite a long time. We often refer, when we're looking this far back, refer to it as, well, this couple thousand, well, that couple thousand. It makes it feel as though it's just a couple hours, right? This was a lengthy process. Corn, the domestication process began in Mesoamerica, and that's what we refer to today as present-day Mexico, and then a little further south into places like Guatemala. In Mesoamerica, this domestication process began with a bushy plant, a wild plant called Teosinte, and it was it had many more branches on it, therefore the nutrients were more dispersed out, not focused, right? Multiple ears with many fewer kernels, unlike the kernels that you have today on the corn on the cob, right? Tons of them. And even the kernels that Teosinte plant produced, they were in this case, very hard case. It made it inedible, right? You couldn't even digest it. And so through selection, right, which is why we have to give these indigenous populations so much credit, through selection they came up with this maize plant, right, or resulted in this maize plant, where you have a main stem, fewer ears, and therefore the nutrients are more focused, concentrated. And of course you have the hundreds on some corn cobs that are supple and easily digestible. An amazing story. Over the next several thousand years, through trade routes, right, maize would make its way into the present day United States, and by the time you have European exploration of the Americas, maize has made its way into the eastern coast, into societies such as the Powhatan in Virginia, and it has already become a main staple of their diet. Cool stuff. But of course, beans and squash were also domesticated. And what's just as amazing about this is think about how you grow this stuff. And that's why I want to share this with you. What indigenous, some indigenous societies started to refer to this as is the three sisters. Why? Because each of these complemented one another. They were symbiotic. They worked together. So for instance, the beans, what do they need? They need something to grow up on. And of course, what does this tall maize, this corn stalk offer? Right? An opportunity for those vines to grow up in. It offers stability to the corn stalk, but something more. Stability is not enough, right? The beans actually have this unique ability to capture nitrogen in the soil, which of course that is vital to corn and many other plants. Finally, the third sister, squash. What does squash offer? How does it help? And of course, we had some heavy rains and flooding here, so I planted my squash a bit too late. So obviously I won't be surviving this season. But the squash will grow this very broad leaf. This leaf will, and the plant overall, will sprawl out over the ground. And that will not only keep in moisture in the soil, right, keep it from evaporating to some degree, but it will also, because of the lack of sunlight on that soil, keep weeds from growing up. Amazing how these three plants work together, but just as amazing is, think about the ingenuity. Think about the trial and error it took these pre-Columbian societies to arrive at these so very effective agricultural practices. We often think about today, right, the science and that ingenuity that does allow our society to thrive, to perpetuate itself. But the work of indigenous peoples of the Americas were just as impressive. And that's what makes history so exciting. Thanks so much for taking the time.